Thank you, Chairwoman Murkowski, and welcome to the former chair, Frank Murkowski. Welcome to the new members of the committee, particularly on our side of the aisle, Senator Duckworth and Senator Cortez Masto. Thank you for being willing to serve on this committee. I look forward, maybe look forward to seeing Mr. Sessions, Senator Sessions on the committee. I don't know. We'll leave that for another day's discussion. And our two colleagues here, thank you for coming to support the nomination of your colleague who has been nominated by the President-elect to be the Secretary of Interior. I'll give you my congratulations on that nomination when we get to the Q&A. But today, we're here to discuss the Office of Secretary of Interior as one of the most important offices of the federal government because it oversees our national parks, wildlife refuge, public lands, and it is responsible for protecting our nation's trust responsibility to Indian country and, as the chair mentioned, to insular areas that frankly get very little attention here and deserve more attention. The Secretary is also responsible for much of the nation's onshore and offshore mineral resources, and it also manages the water resources in western states responsible for our nation's hydro system, something that Senator Wyden and I are very keen on, as well as our colleague from Nevada. It is a far-reaching portfolio, and it is growing and very much impacts our economy. One of the main responsibilities of the Secretary of Interior is overseeing our national parks. The park system includes 417 areas covering more than 84 million acres in every state with an annual operating budget of almost $3 billion and has more than 20,000 employees. But it is also America's treasure, our national parks, and they drive an outdoor economy that provides over 6.1 million jobs and $646 billion in annual revenue. So never underestimate the value of public land when it comes to recreation. Last year was the 100th anniversary of our national parks. And while we passed a very modest improvement to our national parks, I believe our 100-year celebration deserves more, and I look forward to asking the nominee if he agrees with me on that. Americans want us to do more to invest in these crown jewels by providing jobs and recreational opportunities, and something I know we all can agree on, fixing the maintenance backlog. One of the successes that the Senate had last Congress was passing a bipartisan legislation preserving our special places through a bipartisan Land and Water Conservation Fund legislation. And I believe that Congressman Zinke will have a chance to discuss this in his testimony, but I'm sure as an avid sportsman, he knows the value of our public lands and was enthusiastic about us trying to come up with bipartisan legislation to fix the Land and Water Conservation Fund. My constituents want to know, with a new administration, are these public lands going to face an unbelievable attack by those who would like to take these public lands away from us and turn them over back to states? Or are we going to continue to manage these resources for the incredible investment they are and continue to improve so we can get even more economic return? A second major responsibility of the Department of Interior is the management of resource extraction. Over 260 million surface acres, 700 million subsurface acres, and 1.7 billion OCS, Outer Continental Shelf. So today's hearing is about determining whether the nominee is committed to making sure that we minimize environmental harm, that we pay for cleanup, and that we have one fundamental principle that continues to be, and that is that polluters pay. There is and continues to be an opportunity for us to ensure that these public policies, according to the Government Accountability Office, are getting a fair return for the American taxpayer. We have seen over time problems in the fossil fuel program and Interior that, as GAO has said, cost over $200 million a year in lost revenue. The Obama administration took important steps to try to fix these problems. The Deepwater Horizon oil spill in 2010 exposed the consequences of failing to have these kinds of regulations, and so the disaster caused us to put in major reforms at the Department of Interior to make sure important oversight and regulations were not pushed aside and that we monitored these programs. I would have to say that the coal program is one that needs continued focus and attention, and we'll have a chance to talk about this today. The Obama administration has adopted rules to ensure a fair return to taxpayers for our national mineral resources, requiring everyone to pay for mitigation for the damages that they cause. Just today, the Government Accountability Office announced a new conclusion after reviewing multiple types of energy and natural resources. The GAO found that coal mining alone gets a very special treatment in the ability to have bonding for reclamation requirements. Everyone else, oil and gas producers, wind, solar, and even hard rock miners, have to post and cash a third-party bond to make sure that they can clean up the financial surety of the pollution that would be caused. This is something that needs to be addressed by the agency, and I would hope that our nominee would address this. Today's hearing also affords Congressman Zinke the opportunity to demonstrate how he will uphold the trust and treaty obligations to 567 federally recognized tribes. This includes overseeing the Bureau of Indian Affairs and Indian Education and a $2.5 billion budget in Indian country. The reason, Madam Chair, I will take just a minute on this particular point is that our colleagues, many of who serve on this committee, also serve on Indian Affairs, will not have the same chance to point these important issues out to the nominee. But clearly, these issues of stewardship as it relates to tribal lands, support for tribal education, social services and infrastructure, I think regardless of the side of the aisle you sit on, you will hear many things from people both on Indian Affairs and Energy Committee about how important these issues are to the constituents that we represent. It is also critical we understand the nominee's commitment to carrying out our obligations in insular affairs, and as the Chair mentioned, there are many issues that we will get to in the Q&A. But I would like to bring up a few issues as it relates to the Pacific Northwest. There are issues where climate has caused greater impacts on both drought and fire damage. This committee has taken bipartisan efforts to move forward on both of those issues, collaborative efforts to make sure in both Washington and Oregon we are doing all that we can to plan for better resource management of our water supply and build capacity for the future. And we have reached consensus here in the Senate as well on ways to stop fire borrowing and move forward on what are fuel reduction policies that would better serve our federal public lands. I would also mention of particular importance to all of us in the Pacific Northwest, the important pending reauthorization or recommitment of the Columbia River Treaty, the management of our federal hydro system between the United States and Canada. Needs a lot of attention and direction, and we hope that we'll have a chance to ask you questions about that as well. So thank you, Madam Chair. I again congratulate the nominee and look forward to hearing from him and his wife, and I'm here and meeting his family as he makes his introduction.